Urge and Darren from System of a Down. How you doing, guys?
Hello.
Alright.
Good. Well, you've got a new album coming out very soon, Toxicity. It comes out in September. And you just did a video for the first single, right? For Chop Suey.
Yeah.
So let's talk about how you made the album this time and what your approach was to this, your second album. Of course, you had a successful first one to follow up. So what was your approach this time going to the studio?
I think we were more focused on what we wanted to do going into the studio. We knew what kind of album we wanted to make, which was an album that still showed our sound, but yet showed growth. We wanted to be different, yet not change System within the roots, I guess.
Is that difficult? Because you have, once you establish yourself as something, you get a following from it. You have fans that like that. And you don't want to stay in a rut and repeat yourself, but you want to please the people who liked you in the first place. So,
yeah.
Is that really hard? Is that a challenge?
I don't think we try to please anybody but ourselves, so at the end of the day, more than trying to please anybody who liked us in the first place. Because the reason, it's sort of like you got to love yourself before anybody else loves you. And it's that type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
We try to write music that we like. And if we feel that we feel strongly about it, then, I don't know. We got strong opinions, I guess. Like, we're tough people to please, and if we're pleased...
You're your own worst critics.
Yeah,
we're
pleased, then it should probably be alright, you know?
Okay. Alright. I hear you had a lot of songs to choose from. You wrote like 30-some-odd songs for the record. How did you get that down to a manageable amount for the record, for the 14 that are on there?
It was tough.
Okay. I mean, you played some of them live on a radio tour that you did, a little brief couple of appearances, right?
We've played some of the new songs on this album, yes.
And did that help you choose which ones to keep, or did you already decide at that point?
We came to a consensus on it's more of the songs that fit together well,
uh-huh.
You know, we still have a lot of good songs there, but it's more of the songs that I think we all knew where we stand now and what songs fit together in that scheme.
What are you doing with all the leftovers?
They're still there.
These are B-sides or?
Well, it depends. You know, like a movie soundtrack might come along and need a song. Sometimes they don't want a song that's on the album.
Right.
There's a hell of a lot of material there that's really good. And the only reason that it didn't all get on there is because we don't want to make a record that was over 45 minutes long.
Or a double album, as our self.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you could use them again, but then, you know, a lot of bands look at the stuff that they save and they go, nah, let's go write something new, you know?
Well, we'll definitely write more new stuff, but there is a lot of good material there, and the only reason it's not there is because we don't want to make a record that's over 45 minutes long. There's a lot of records these days that come out that are like an hour.
You think that's too much for a fan to listen to at one time?
Well, it depends on the record, but I just think for what we do, it's usually, even with the songs, it's pretty much like you go through a lot of stuff, but
mm-hmm.
within 2.5 minutes, you know, 3 minutes, and I think...
that's enough time to tell the story and
If you can pull it off in that amount of time, then I'd rather mm-hmm. do it short than have it long and drawn out, you know.
Tell me about your writing process and how you work. Do you all sit in a room and come up with ideas, bring things to each other, write completed songs on your own? How?
Mostly
always?
Darren writes most of the music of the band, and he pretty much writes it in his room
mm-hmm.
and brings it fully arranged. Sometimes we change arrangements on it and whatnot. I bring in some music, and Chello brings in some music as well.
Mm-hmm.
Darren's also brought in a lot of lyrics on this record, as well as a lot of melodies and everything.
So it's pretty much a collaboration.
It's a collaboration. We do, we jam live, but we generally don't write songs, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we don't write songs as a unit. Like, I write a lot of the songs, but everybody puts in their, I mean, yeah, it's not like, I write the songs, everybody shut up.
Sure.
You know what I mean? That doesn't work like that. It's pretty much like, hey, here's a song, and everybody does whatever they can do to
mm-hmm.
make it better. And that's sort of how it, you know what I mean? Like, that's how it is, pretty much.
So you started working on it, like, right before you went into the studio, or did you have stuff from the whole past year?
I've been working on it since we were finished the last record.
Okay.
I mean, it's working. I write music. That's what I
do. So you do that kind of all the time?
Yeah.
I noticed that a lot of artists, just meeting different musicians and stuff mm-hmm. that they write when they need to write. And mm-hmm. like Darren, I know.
It's an ongoing process.
He's always writing. I always write too mm-hmm. when I'm in town specifically. But you know, mm-hmm. it's just yeah. Mm-hmm. I think that's really good because it develops you as an artist beyond what you're, you know,
sure.
what you need to do as far as your record or mm-hmm. for the band. Or
I never really write for the record though. It's like I write stuff and some stuff is for, you know, I sit there and say, hey, that'd be cool for System. And then I write some stuff and say, hey, that'd be cool for something else I might want to do later on. But it's like nothing dies. It's always
right.
still there. The ideas are still in the air and stuff. But mm-hmm. it's pretty much, you know, working on stuff and picking and choosing what to take to the band and what to leave for myself for something else, you know?
Okay.
And, yeah.
So you work with Rick Rubin again. What does he bring to the process? What kind of a
beard.
Okay. Well, as far as the working relationship that you have that you've developed over time, how can you describe that?
He's just a really good vibe. He's like a guy who doesn't play an instrument or anything. He's like a listener that you sit there and say, I respect this guy's ear. I respect, like, if he says, like, he digs a song, I'll be like, cool. Some people you respect their opinions more than others, and I think a producer is someone pretty much is like easier, you know, fifth opinion.
It's like your sounding board in a way.
Yeah, sort of like to tell you, well, you know, that song is like, wow, that's really cool. It's like we're so into the songs, we're inside of the songs. We need someone that's from the outside.
More objective voice.
Yeah, and he comes in with, you know, a lot of cool ideas in pre-production. Like if there is something that stands out in the song and maybe we didn't realize that that part stands out so much, he'll be like, well, why don't you try repeating that, you know? Or, like, for years we played X with doing the chorus with only one measure. I think now we've doubled it to two measures. And, like...
That was his idea.
And it was his idea. He goes, hey, why don't you just do the middle of the chorus one? And we don't... It's not like, well, okay, Rick said it, we have to do it. It's sort of like, we try it. It's good. And if we like it, we're like, wow, why didn't we think of that?
Yeah.
And then if we don't like it, we're like, well, we don't really like it. He's like, well, cool, just a suggestion.
So it's a pretty good relationship.
Very comfortable working relationship, mm-hmm. and you know he knows how, in subtle ways how to inspire us. I think lyrically he's inspired certain things where I've had a couple of snags or you know.
Can you give me an example?
Chop Suey. At the end of Chop Suey, going into the last chorus where all, you know, the rhythm changes and everything's changing. I was trying to come up with something there that ties it in really good, and he didn't really recommend anything, but he was recommending a bunch of books at the time mm-hmm. to me, and I was reading through them, and because certain things I was saying was reminding him of a certain topic, so he would recommend a book, then I'd read the book, and something another idea.
So he fed more ideas.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, you know, that's a subtle way of doing it. Sometimes we just open a book and point to a word, and it would be the word
really?
We were looking for a word, okay. and stuff like stream of consciousness stuff.
Mm-hmm. Talk about some of the other lyrical inspirations. I know you have some songs in there. Toxicity, for example, the title of the album comes from Toxic City, right? Can you go into that a little bit?
Well, toxicity itself is a word. It's not just toxic city.
Right.
It's toxicity of the
play
city,
on words.
For example. But it's a play on words in the sense that it makes people think of that. And that's why Darren wanted to actually pick it as the album.
Well, he made the word up, but I wanted it to be the album title.
Uh-huh.
But I'm gonna made the word up.
No, it's an actual.
It's an actual word.
It's
we didn't know that. That's what they said. We thought of it. So that's fair.
It would be actually two C's then, toxic and sin. You know, you blended it into toxicity, which is a word.
I know.
But it's the thing.
It can,
you know what I'm saying, right?
Yeah, I do.
I think the word can mean a lot of different things. Like, it can mean toxic city. It could mean the state of being intoxicated. I mean,
mm-hmm.
and just, you know, anything. Like, it's sort of like open to interpretation, just like the band name, System of a Down. What the fuck does that mean? And people always ask us that. I'm like,
sure.
What does it mean to you? And that's what it means.
So you like to keep things a little bit vague so people can think about it, right?
Well, yeah, that's how...
Still a reason, I mean... You know.
They've sort of taken the imagination away from music, and they being, I don't know who, but I just see that happening
mm-hmm.
where it's sort of like there's less of a mystery sometimes, and you gotta keep... Like, you know, people used to listen to Beatles lyrics and sit there and say, you know, what the fuck are they singing about? You know what I mean? They must be singing about something that, you know, that's some trippy thing, you know? And like,
yeah.
And with us, and we use the same sort of type of symbolisms, like, for maybe sometimes we might be singing about something really serious. Like, for example, the song Needles,
okay.
You know, is a really serious song, and is pretty much a song that has a lot to do with addiction. And a lot to do with, you know, just serious things. And, you know, the chorus is pretty much pull the tapeworm out of your ass, hey. that lightens it up
yeah.
to people, but the topic is still pretty serious.
Well, I think that's also Psycho is like that, too.
Oh, it's, Psycho is the best example.
Yeah,
it makes you want to cry and laugh all at the same time.
Sure, you've known some people like that, right? A few.
No comment.
No comment. Want to incriminate yourself. How about prison? My prison. I mean, you had an experience that didn't you?
A prison experience.
Wasn't there something I wrote about yeah. that fueled that song? You want to elaborate on that a bit?
It's just, you know, the song says it all in itself, where it's sort of like, you know, he pretty much covers with his lyrics, he covers the ground of how it's pretty much a the way the powers that be or whoever it is plays this game with the drugs, and in the song my character sometimes plays the guy who is pretty much the victim, you know, like I buy my crack, my slam, my bitch, you know, right here in Hollywood, the glamorous city of Hollywood, you know what I mean? If you haven't been here before, then you sit there and say, wow, I'm gonna see theaters, you know,
it's the idealized
version. The idea. Well, you know, that's what toxicity sort of brings into play too, is where it's like, you know, here's Hollywood, and I grew up in Hollywood, and the Hollywood that you see is Mr. Movie Star. The Hollywood I see is like pimps, hookers, drug dealers, and bitches, and whatever the fuck it is. You know what I mean? And
different side.
It's the darker side of Hollywood, and with the song Prison, you know, like I said, he pretty much catches, like, you know what, it's that game they play. They put the drug in the street, and the guy buys the drugs, and then they put him into court, and then they put him into jail, then the lawyers get money, and then the lawyers make money off the judges, and the judges make money off the lawyers, and that's the game that I played, and that's what happened in jail life. There was this whole crazy thing where, fine, I was lucky enough to have money in my pocket to get my ass out of jail. I had warrants for like $12,500.
What was it, traffic tickets or something?
Yeah, I had warrants, but then on top of that, I had pot on me, so it was like, and I just found out yesterday that I was still on probation, and I didn't even know it, but now my probation just got lifted, too, though, so that was cool.
Drama.
But, you know, this is the game they play. They put it on the street, and then they put you on the probation and make you feel like you're like an animal, and we've got you on check, and then that's pretty much it. Yeah.
If they really wanted to end the drug problem in the United States, they would work on the demand side, not the supply side. They spend all those billions in Colombia and everywhere else fighting, using weapons, American weapons, to kill people and you know, burn acres of land and this and that. The real problem is in America. People here are the drug users. So, and to eliminate that and to decrease it, you need treatment. That's the only proven method. Not law enforcement. Law enforcement doesn't do anything. Mandatory minimum sentencing just puts people with pot on them in jail for a long time. With, like, you know, people that have killed people, you know?
Yeah, and it's a disease, so it's sort of like condemning. It's like taking someone to jail because they got AIDS.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Or someone, you know, your friend didn't always have AIDS, just like maybe your friend didn't always do drugs.
Mm-hmm.
So he picked up this disease along the way.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, you're sort of taking him to jail for the same reasons, in my eyes, you know?
You guys use your music to make a lot of commentary, social commentary and political commentary. Is the message as important as the music? I mean, is it as one? One needs the other?
So some of the commentary we make are completely humorous things, though. You know, people tend to focus on the social political commentary, but they're generally 4 out of 14 songs or 5 out of 14 songs. So to really do the album justice, I would have to say that there's many different songs.
Oh yeah, no, I know that.
About many different topics, and not most of them not necessarily social.
Yeah. It's funny because we have a funny way of some bands. Either they're like sex, drugs, rock and roll, or politics. We're like sex, drugs, rock and roll, and Paul.
Well, it's all and Paul.
Politics, drugs, all of it. It's all in part of what
right.
we live in, so it's all there. Why not?
So you use personal experience and you use observance and all of that and just
everything.
Mix it all up.
Anything that's inspirational, man.
Mm-hmm.
Anything that's inspirational. This interview can inspire us. The memory of this interview maybe can inspire us one day to say, hey, you know, we were in that room reminded us of this, and this is what we want to write out of
it all.
And so the stem of it was this room, but we'll go from this room to talking about, like, horses and
violence. This couch reminds me of, like, an old Chevy van with an 8-track in it.
Yeah. Maybe it came from an old Chevy van.
Probably, huh?
Probably.
I mean, the inspiration doesn't stop from wherever you can get it. You know?
Okay.
I mean, it's not just music that inspires, it's everything. Life.
When you had a successful album the first time around, which you did, it went gold, almost platinum, do you feel a pressure or put any pressure on yourselves to live up to that level and to do another one, so to speak? Does that do it to play at all?
I mean, as a writer, there was, if you'd asked me the question 2 years ago, I would have said, yeah. But as time went on, I sort of psyched myself out of that mode. I was home for a little while, so I got myself into a stable sort of life, and I got myself away from thinking about, you know, industry, away from thinking about what kind of interviews we're going to do, and just stuff like that, and radio or anything, and just said, you know, the first time around, you didn't give a shit. This time around, just don't give a shit. If you think it sounds good, take it to the band. If they think it sounds good, then take it to the street.
Focus on what you're doing and leave everything else out the door.
It's
right?
not easy. It wasn't easy for me, at least. I mean, it's you know. But the competition doesn't lie with other bands. The competition is with ourselves. You know, it's sort of like, you know, what can I do to still keep that power in System of a Down? Not necessarily aggressive power or any sort of, just that spiritual power, yet and be true to ourselves and be something that we love. Like, what can we do to grow? You know, what can we do to get inspired? Where can I get inspired from? Hockey games is where I find.
There you go. Is that
you? Well, most of the time. Yeah.
Okay. How long have you guys known each other? When did you first
meet? A
while.
When did you
first
meet?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
9 years. And I remember, since we still go to the same school together, there's like a few years between us.
Uh-huh.
So since we still go to the same school together, like me and Shao, when we...
Me look better.
Michelle and him.
You all were friends, right? Before you started
the
band.
Well, yeah, we all went to the same elementary school.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, we didn't hang out together because of age differences and stuff.
But you were aware of one another.
Aware of one, yeah.
Did you all want to be musicians from the time you were small? Was that something you always wanted?
Everyone except
you came into it later on?
I came into it later on, yeah. I was in college and I started playing keyboards and... You know, my parents actually were encouraging of music when I was younger, but I didn't take it up.
Huh.
And,
nobody pushed me. My parents are both artists, and they were like, don't do that, you're going to suffer.
And you didn't listen.
I know, no, they weren't, like, against it. They were just worried about, like, is it?
Right, being able to support yourself, is that what they
mean? Well, they're both artists, and they know it's a tough life to live. You know, it's not an easy living to be an artist. I mean... In any form, even once you're starting to, if you're truly into what you do, even like the money that comes into play and stuff, that doesn't make an artist's life any easier, because I still feel like I don't think I'll ever be completely satisfied and happy, because I'm always trying to achieve something more with the art, with the craft. So it's like, yeah, fine, money's coming, cool, I got a bigger house now, nice car. But I still think I suck.
But that's in a way that's good, because it drives your drive to improve, you know.
Yeah, it's not very healthy though. But I at the end of the day, I wouldn't trade that feeling, because it does make me try to achieve more. You know?
Sure. What about influences? Can you talk about that a little bit, and where you draw them? I know you have, like, your heritage plays into it a bit, right? The Armenian heritage plays into some
not
of that.
Not as much as people think it does.
Well, there's some tones and sounds I hear, right, that you borrow from. I know it's not the major part
it's
of it.
It's more Maiden that influenced me with more of that Mediterranean type of vibe than anything else.
Okay.
Honestly, it's like people think that you know, we sat there. He might have listened to a lot more of actual Armenian music than me. Mm-hmm. With me, because it's the music sometimes they talk about, and they say, well, I do a solo, and they say, well, that's very Arabic. And I was like, well, if I was a white dude, you wouldn't say that. You know what I mean? Like, the guys from Maiden do these crazy melodic Mediterranean mm-hmm. solos. And nobody ever says that to him because they're a bunch of dudes from Britain. It's like, just sometimes
that's
when
you're true. Is it annoying?
Well, sometimes that art were like Armenian rock. What the fuck was Armenian rock? If we weren't Armenian, would that be Armenian rock?
Yeah.
You know, like that's we'd still be playing this music. It wouldn't have changed. I mean, I grew up in the United States. I grew up in Hollywood.
That's true. So you're all from out here originally, right? You're all from California.
Well, they were born here.
I wasn't born here, but I grew up here. Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty much all over the
world.
We're
born. So tell us about the video shoot that you did the other day for Chop Suey. It was quite a marathon, right?
Well, it was a marathon for the kids.
You had 500 kids who came to the website.
And for our backs.
Because
it's really bad. Marathon.
It was like going to a system show and watching system for 8 hours, and I would be like, fuck, they're getting boring. But they didn't feel
that
way.
They were into it. They were into it.
Well, because we didn't make them have to listen to Chop Suey a bunch of times. Like, we went in there, we put all our equipments, we had them on live, uh-huh. We plugged them all in.
So you played other songs too.
Yeah,
so we pretty much played a lot of old songs, a lot of new songs.
They got a full concert out of the
Well, they got a lot of things we wouldn't have probably normally done.
Yeah, uh-huh.
You know, they got me to sing Whitney Houston.
Get out. What song?
What else? Yeah, I will always love
you. Oh my God.
No, but like...
The yodels were now.
Like, stuff they would never probably see at a system show. Or maybe they would. I don't know. Fuck, we never know what we're going to do when we get on the stage anyway. But like...
So you got all that on camera tape, right?
Just,
you could use
yeah,
something.
But just so it wouldn't be like, you know, chop suey. I could really see us and the people start to get bored. And I didn't want
yeah.
it would be sort of cheesy for the energy to be fake. So every time we played a new song, their energy got back up. And then when they heard Chop Suey again for the video, they were
still there.
They were still there and they still didn't get sick.
And it made a big difference to us too, because we've shot a couple of videos before and just as far as performance, having the kids there makes
yeah.
it real.
Put some speed off, right? It's not just
yeah.
vacuum type.
It's not just playback
yeah.
and go.
Exactly.
You know?
Good. So that's the singles on the radio already, I understand, is doing very well.
Yeah.
Which bodes well. For
number one most requested on KRPM last night.
Fantastic.
Right before I left the RV, I heard
that's great.
It's just nice, man. I mean, like, but the funky thing is about System of a Down is we did not write, or still do not write, or ever will write any of this shit to get on the radio. We don't write any of it to get on the radio. We don't write it to get an MTV or, you know, thank you for doing the interview. But at the end of the day, we didn't write it to get the interview.
I know.
You know, so it's sort of like...
So everything that happens is just a plus, really.
No, it's a plus, but it's also a surprise. You know, it's sort
mm-hmm.
of like,
mm-hmm.
you know, when Sugar got played on the radio.
You weren't expecting it.
What the fuck kind of song is Sugar to get played on the radio compared to all the other songs that get played on the radio? You know what I mean? Like, it's like this jazzy hardcore song. What the fuck is a jazzy hardcore song? So it's like, it's not like, there's this format that they go by. And
you don't think you fit in it.
We don't fit into that format. It's not that I think.
The time changes.
Yeah, well, what do you think about the current music scene, and where do you think it's going?
I don't feel involved in it. Like, there's this new metal thing that everybody seems
huh?
to be talking
about. Yeah, spelled
with
an N-U.
Well, I don't think he does. I don't think anybody in our band feels
yeah.
like we're involved in we play... music and metal is definitely an influence from what we do,
mm-hmm.
but there is this collaborated sound that goes with the new metal genre, which is a pretty trendy type of thing, I think. And we don't do trends. We're not a trendy type of band. We're not trying. What the fuck? We're four Armenian guys. What kind of trend is that? You know what I mean? Like we're not trying to, you know, be the flavor of the month. We're not. We don't want anybody to make us that. We don't want. I don't know, we're really trying to do something that is our own thing.
Well, I think that's
like,
good. I think when you are doing something unique and novel and on your own, it may be harder to just to get that first initial start because it's out of the norm. But then again, you're not following anybody. You're not like cloning anybody. You're doing your own thing, so
that's
it's more original.
That's what you get out of the title of new metal. you either get a band that sounds like Korn, or you either get a band that sounds like Limp Bizkit, or Deftones. And if you were to tell me those bands that I just mentioned, I'd say cool, but then there's all these bands that followed them, and it's like, that's that whole scene that, you know,
Does that happen all the time, though? Any time that something successful, people try to jump on that?
And the thing is, like Korn, for example, I give Korn a lot of respect because they came out. Nobody sounded like Korn when they came out, so I say, fuck yeah.
Leaders of that particular
thing. That's what I say. I say, fuck yeah, man. Hats off to Korn, but, like, what's up with all these people who can't, like, I can understand, okay, you like Korn, but don't you have any ideas of your own? You know what I mean? Why you gotta mimic Korn?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the problem I got. And the beauty of it is with System of a Down is we can't copy ourselves and nobody else can copy us.
There you go. That's the formula right there.
The key is
So as far as shows go, I understand you're going to Miami to do a show there this week, right? Is that like a radio thing
that
you're
doing?
Radio show.
That's a fucking humidity
show. It's a humidity show. Yeah, I know. Miami in August. What else? The shows beyond that you
booked? We're going to do some festivals in Europe, Leeds, Reading, and Lowlands.
In August this
in
month?
In August this month.
Mm-hmm.
Then we're going to come back and do some promo shows here, LA, New York.
They're going to be a local one?
One in LA. Okay. Trying to plan something, I think, with K-Rock, if I'm not mistaken.
This is all news to me, by the way.
Okay.
We're doing a tour with Slipknot. Us and Slipknot are co-headlining this.
Which will be when?
Pledge of Allegiance tour. Sorry. Got something to say.
And that September 14th. In September? When does that run through?
September 14th through late October.
I've heard some rumor about in November there's supposed to be some huge tour that you might be part of with White Zombie, with Rob Zombie rather,
and
Sabbath. Is that going to happen?
I'm not sure.
But you've heard of it.
I've heard something about it.
Okay, so it's a possibility then.
Yeah,
so you'll be on the road from into the next year, I assume.
Well,
right?
We plan on doing, you know, what we did last time for this record. We didn't gain our fans from, I mean, we might have gotten played on the radio, but that was sort of like a tail end of all of it.
Yeah.
Might have gotten some MTV play, tail end of all of it. Everything we've achieved is from touring. Yeah.
Isn't that the way to go, though? Grassroots?
Well, if you want, I just feel like if you want to look at your fans and get some, just if you're giving something real and if you want to get something real back, that's the way to do it. I don't want to be shoved down anybody's throat and say, and it's pretty tough not to do that under, you know, a corporate type of vibe that we're under with Columbia and stuff, but I don't want to be like, you know, shoved down anybody's throat and say, here's System of a Down so much that you just have to know what it is. That gets to be force fed, and right now it's sort of like, we just went to Europe. And,
how'd that go?
Well, there's this word of mouth, like, the thing about System in Europe is, like, it's more to, like, kids passing out tapes to each other and CDs, and it's word of mouth more than it's some sort of machine that's pushing it.
Right, more organic.
Yeah.
It's less organized radio than
But that's somewhat of the way we've gained our respect and our vibe here in the States, is that friends told friends, internet through internet, and people from this part of the world to that part of the world, even before we were signed. And basically, you know, that's the way I want to achieve what we get, is through touring, you know what I mean? Like, that interaction, letting them in.
You look at a band like Tool or Rage that are worth, you know, that bring in huge, huge crowds. As when they tour, they set up huge places. And the amount of records they sell in comparison is less, if you know what I mean, than a band that might be selling 5 to 7 million. That might pack less houses is because they actually have street credibility.
Mm-hmm.
They've toured, they've done their job, and people love to see
them. And most of those bands that get played on, that get their radio success, get smoked on stage anyway, usually.
Yeah, and then they can't really follow it up, and they go away quicker.
Because they might have made a nice video, and it's really easy to make yourself look really cool in the video, but to make that come off just as powerful live, then people will be like, what happened to them? You know, they're not as exciting.
It doesn't look up to the hype.
Yeah, it's not as exciting as it was on the video, you know? So that's the thing where it's like, we toured our asses off for about 2 or 3 years. We'll do it again for this album.
You prefer the live situation or the studio, or are they both equally fun and challenging for you?
Different vibes, different characters, different. You gotta psych yourself out to a different vibe. Yeah.
What can people expect from the show this year? Have you thought about the set list yet, or is it?
A lot of a lot of little unseen tricks.
We don't fucking know. We're even bullshitting them. We go on stage and we're like, but
what?
Are they happening?
Yeah.
What?
Are we gonna go through it?
Share.
So, it depends.
Oh, we just got this light show thing that we've got in mind, and we're just hoping and praying that it happens, and it happens right. It's just this fire. Yeah, it's sort of like we want to try our best to make the people focus on music, and if we can make it, you know, visual and try to take the attention. Maybe away from the stage, you know what I mean? That's just an idea. We always do something different, you know what I mean? Sometimes we come out. If you've seen pictures of System of a Down through the last 3 years, you might have seen us look like all makeuped out. Then you might have seen us just look normal, or you might have seen, him look in a certain more drawn up way, me more glammed out. Just to leave.
You kind of mix it up a bit.
Well, we hit all of those characters that live in each one of us, and each one of us does a different thing, what I mean? Like, he doesn't get all glammed out, because it's not in his vibe, it's not natural to him. To me, I grew up on stuff like that. Like, I love the fucking New York Dolls. I'm a huge Stooges fan, and it's just part of what I love, you know? But then there's a part of me that grew up with a bunch of gangsters. So there's, like, there's a very unglam side of me, too. So it's like, it's that mix that... That's why I don't think we can explain it. It's like worlds that don't belong together, but they
melt somehow.
For some reason they fit. Like me and this guy, our view on the world sometimes is the same, but like just the way we live, the way he gets up and lives his life and the way I get up and live my life is like completely different. But for some odd reason it just like meshes together and we get along together like brothers, and like he tells me something and I learn, I'm sure I tell him something and I open him to things that we never both, like, I bet I can rev him up and he can mellow me out, or vice versa.
That's the balance that you have.
Great. We've had a long, beautiful relationship and still do, and, I have a feeling we're starting to see things more the same way. We should go back to
maybe meet more in the middle.
We're starting to see things more the same way.
You know what's funny is as time has gone by, usually it ruins relationships, like what we do, as a band and stuff like that. Like, especially after, me and him might have gone into some sort of, like, arguments together during the record and stuff, but that's two creative minds.
Yeah, that's
and
normal.
And that's normal, but at the time you get, really revved up or hurt or whatever happens. But, like, through all that crap, like, where we sit right now with me and this, Serge and me, and even in the rest of the guys, but especially me and Serge, it's sort of like this, I haven't felt healthier. I haven't felt as comfortable in the band as I do right now. And not with only Serge and me, just like with Shavo and John and everybody. Like, where I sit in the band right now, I feel like very, like, wow, I know how they know me, I know how I know them, and it feels like we all sort of, like, have learned to... I know they know how to push my buttons, and I know how to push theirs, and it's so close that it's like brothers. Like, I've never felt so comfortable in the band before. Like, even before when we first started, it was still like, it was, the growing pains still happened, but we've been through a lot of growing pains. So to live through what we've lived through, we should have broken them about a million times.
Well, what kept you together, do you think?
Love and. The respect for one another. Like, at the end of the day, I like hanging out with him. what I mean? Like,
I don't know why. No one else does.
I don't want that to stop, though. Like, I don't really hang out with very many people, Like, there's not very many people that come into my life and say, hey, you're my friend now, So it's like, it's who I've got, so I try to keep.
What about the future? I mean, what goals do you set now? And, obviously some bands last a few years, some last decades. I mean, do you see yourself doing this for a long time? And what do you plan for the future of this band and then things on your own? I know, so you write poetry, and you have a poetry website, and you're signing bands to a label, right? You have all this stuff.
I personally don't believe in the word past or future. I believe in the now, and I believe what you created, but I do believe in visualization. I think that this band is an amazing creative force, and each member of this band is an amazing creative force, even by themselves. And I think a lot of good things will come out of this band. In the long run, and I think there'll be some really interesting, challenging music that'll come up to the surface from this band?
I mean, I think there's going to come a time that, I would hope not, but I don't think break the band up, you know what I mean? There's a time where you say, hey, you know, as an artist, I want to go, I'm producing a band right now called The Ambulance.
Oh.
And, you know, they've got some label interest, and when they get signed, mm-hmm. I'm going to put my mind into start producing. I want to produce more bands. But, like, the thing is that there's going to come a time, like, we'll make another record and stuff, but I think we'll know when the time is right where we'll pretty much be like, no, I need to get this itch.
Scratch that.
You know, like, I want to go and do this, or and like you said, there's so many different, like, shallow DJs, you know, and like maybe he might go do something off with that, you know, and it's like.
Doesn't all that help when you bring it back to the band? When you bring it back to
at the end of the day, we'll see, before I went in to record the album with the band, I produced this band called The Ambulance, mm-hmm. and it got me like in this whole different, it made me so much better in the studio after it was sort of like, wow, dude, I just realized a lot of things that helped me with System that came from that experience. So mm-hmm. it's like anytime you collaborate with somebody else, you can come and bring it back to the table and say, hey, look what I learned, you know, and it makes the whole thing better. I mean, it's just you're adding influence to it, and if each, we're one, System now is one person made of four people, but it's just one vibe. And if somebody can come in and throw in an extra something into that whole thing, it's sort of like, you know, it always makes it better.
One last thing I wanted to ask you about the web and how important your website has been to you as far as promotion and getting the word out about the band. I know that's how you got the people to come to the video, right?
Yeah,
and you're elaborating on that.
That's how we got fans to begin with.
We had a website really early on. We had some friends that hooked us up and didn't charge us anything before we had management, before we had a label. And we put the songs up in audio so people can listen to it. And, you know, it automatically started making fans. We started getting fans all over the world.
So it's been really much of a big
factor. It's been a very, very powerful marketing as well as, you know, factor in keeping us in touch with them as well.
So you go on there pretty much a lot and post new things, but... You know, as a band.
I go check it out, I post stuff and mm-hmm. get a bunch of emails. Mm-hmm. You know, I haven't, at first I used to give my emails out, like,
and then
on
you get
it,
flooded.
And then I'd get, a lot of people still know it, so they still hit me up. I still get a lot, but at least it's not 1,000 a day because I can't handle it.
I mean, before we were signed, that's what we used to promote ourselves. Before any label or anything, mm-hmm. we put out 60,000 demos. So by the time we went on tour with Slayer, our album wasn't even out yet, but you'd always find like this group of like maybe 10 to 15 kids in the front row singing along, you know, singing along word for word lyrics of a band that's a local band out of LA, not local to them, but like an unsigned band out of LA, mm-hmm. whose album's not out, and there's today we had these three songs, we had War, No, and People, and every time we played those songs on the set, the kids knew, and they were singing along. We were thousands of miles away from Los Angeles, and I think that computer had a big thing to do with that.
So that's systemofadown.com, right, for everybody who doesn't know. All right. Well, guys, I thank you so much for this.
Thank you.
I wish you much luck with the album and everything.
Thank
we'll see you on the road.
Awesome.
Thank you.